Stephen, the Bank of Canada ended 2022 signaling a pause with respect to interest rate increases. What is the expectation from the central bank for the new year?
Well, good question. And the bank itself is letting us know that the whole process will be data dependent from here on. My metaphor is when you're in a strange hotel room in the middle of the night, you may jump out of bed in the middle of the night to visit the washroom, but you feel your way from there because you don't really want to turn on the lights and wake yourself up. So we're at that point where we've done the obvious thing, move rates at least to neutral and, of course, a little bit above neutral. And now we need to see how the economy is responding and what other shocks it gets hit by along the way. My own sense of this is that most of the work has been done, maybe even all of it, that inflation probably will fall faster than most people think over the course of 23.
We were operating in a period of uncertainty post-pandemic, and it seems that uncertainty continues with inflation and geopolitics. How do you operate in a landscape of uncertainty?
Well, there you go. It's a matter of risk management as opposed to a mechanical or engineering type of process to target inflation. And you certainly can't target inflation by looking in the rearview mirror and seeing whether or not it's come down. But I think in the environment we'll be into, as we saw earlier with U.S. inflation, we're going to have several observations in the coming months where we're going to do better than markets think. So disinflation relief will be the pervasive market theme, I think, through the year. And as that happens, it's still a matter of calibration to see how much more work has to be done to fundamentally get everything back to where we were before the pandemic arose. That will certainly happen, but it might take another 18 months. And so that's an uncertain period where central banks and investors together will be weighing the scenarios that are possible. There could be a whole new round of commodity price increases, perhaps, as we go forward. That's something that we need to be aware of as a shock. Or we could have a complete quietening down there, and in that case, a very fast deceleration in inflation. And labor markets are a favorite indicator these days. And indicators probably aren't telling us the complete story, given that we got a major retirement wave happening. Same sort of confusion we had in the early 1970s, except in reverse. So for all those reasons, I think we have to, especially as investors, be prepared for more than one path forward and, of course, protect ourselves from the adverse ones.
How do you think about the possibility of a downturn for 2023?
Well, a downturn is reasonably likely to happen. I think of it more as an altitude correction rather than a downturn, if you like. The economy got too high in altitude, like a plane that got to 40,000 feet and it's supposed to be at 35. Too much turbulence up here, so they're working on getting it back down to 35. The question you're asking is, do we have to go to 30,000 feet temporarily while we're getting back to 35? And that's conceivable. But none of that has to be a hard landing, soft landing. It's not a landing at all. It's just an altitude correction. The economy is fundamentally very strong. So if we have a measured recession, or I call it a technical recession, it's not a very painful thing in this situation. It is definitely going to be one of those ones that's going to be an easy ride by comparison.
Stephen, you had just mentioned that the economy is fundamentally strong. How attractive does this make Canada as a space for business investment?
Well, we know from the data that it hasn't been very attractive at all for a number of years. If you looked in the fall economic statement, you saw charts that started, in 2015. Canada's investment, not just in the energy sector, but in all sectors, has lagged the rest of the OECD since around 2015. Mostly, I think that's to do with uncertainty around NAFTA in the early days, and now uncertainty about the future of energy sector for another. In general, I think we need to do more work to make ourselves attractive. It's a very competitive world. There are a lot of places that one can invest in. Everybody is into a growth phase, and everybody is deploying new technology, and everybody is going into the green energy space. So there's opportunities for all investors, and Canada is in a most competitive situation that's ever been. So we need to be more competitive on that front. And that's going to take some doing. We need clarity for investors. We need a level playing field for investors. And we aren't offering these things right now.
Let's talk a little bit about Canada's energy sector. And you had mentioned the green energy space. And of course, we know that the government has been ambitious with its net zero policies. Is there space for Canada's oil and gas sector in the energy transition?
Well, there certainly is. If we take the notion of net zero seriously, a lot of people I speak to seem to think that net zero means zero, but it doesn't. You could have a net zero balance sheet as a business or as a household, and that could mean either having zero of everything or having a huge house and a huge mortgage and having net zero. There's more than one way of getting to net zero, and it's certainly the case for energy. And one of the ways, or many of the ways, would see Canada's traditional fossil fuel sector being an important contributor, not just to the transition, but a contributor to the energy needs of the world long term. But that requires a twin strategy, which is where we become a leader in carbon capture, utilization, and storage, such that we are literally taking care of people's business so they can responsibly use fossil fuels. That's technically feasible. It's just a matter of us getting our act together and being willing to make those investments. I think that's where we should be focusing our efforts. If we did that, I think, yes, we can be, you know, it can be Star Trek, and we're still providing the plastics that people need and the energy that people need. So the demand for energy for the world, Larysa, will go up by 50 or 60% over the next 30 years. People aren't really taking that into account when they talk about the transition. The transition needs actually to transition plus increase capacity dramatically.
Tied closely to oil has been the dollar, perhaps not as of late, though. Mm-hmm. What is the speculation on the trajectory of the loonie for this year?
Yeah, so it's true that the loonie has had a whole year of undervaluation relative to important fundamentals such as oil prices. Normally, we would have expected the loonie to go probably to around 90 cents or even higher during the first few months of Putin's invasion of Ukraine. And that didn't happen. In fact, the loonie depreciated in that context. And this is one of the reasons why Canadian inflation has been so high. Imagine if the Canadian dollar had reacted normally, our inflation rate would have peaked at a far lower rate than what we actually saw. That reason for that is because we've not been very clear with the energy sector about the future, you know, to wit the question you just asked. And so if we were clearer about the destination and what it will look like along the way, I think we would see a revitalization of investment in that sector. And if that were to happen, then I think the Canadian dollar would begin moving back towards those fundamentals. So in my sense is that over the next year, we will get more clarity around the future of the energy sector. And in that case, we'll have more investment in the sector. And as a result, the Canadian dollar is more likely to rise than to fall over the next 12 months.
Stephen, you had mentioned labor as a theme going into 2023. How closely tied are immigration targets, the immigration process, to what happens with Canada's labor landscape?
Well, very. In 2023, we will not domestically produce any growth in our workforce at all. All of the growth that we achieve will be through immigration. So that's, you know, when you're thinking about what's your GDP growth target for a normal year, you may get one percentage point from immigration, and the rest you get will become from productivity. And our productivity performance has been lackluster, so we can really only count on the immigration part. So that's critical. And it's also important that it be, you know, the right kind of mix of immigrants. It's not that they're not all fungible. Of course, the skill sets may not be a great match for what we need here in Canada. So we have to be willing to get them quickly into training, on the job training in particular, and ensure that we get good matches through that. But the main thing is to have good numbers, in universities. Universities are by far our strongest channel of immigration. And yet it takes years for someone who graduates from a Canadian university to achieve permanent resident status. We need to put more money and more technology to work in this and change our system so we can streamline those things. Otherwise, we'll be struggling to grow at all over the next 5 years.
Curious to get your thoughts on Canada's housing for the new year. Towards the end of 2022, we saw house prices decline. We saw rent prices increase, giving Canada this rather expensive reputation.
Well, owned housing is for sure going through a correction, as well it should, because we know things got overheated. But the real background of this is a house or a condo is really just a bond. It delivers something to you every month forever, just like a bond does. And when interest rates go to zero, its present value goes up a lot. And therefore, the price of housing was being boosted by really low interest rates. And now a normalization of interest rates reverses some of this. So we have to live through that correction. But meanwhile, underneath that is this very strong floor, which is coming from that immigration flow, more than one percentage point growth, at a time when we're actually building fewer houses than that. And even if we build the right number of houses, if we manage to do this, which I really doubt, and I should say not houses, but homes, because it's very likely to be condos and so on, If we build exactly the right amount, those existing home prices would continue to rise simply because our cities, the major cities, are getting larger. And so in that context, the outlook is a pretty positive one. It's a sector that needs to get through these high input costs and get those back under control. And of course, the rental market suffers from that as well. So if we don't do a better job on this, we may fail on our immigration plans and thereby fail in our growth plans that we talked about a few moments ago. So all those things are connected and we need to do a better job on them.
And lastly, your thoughts on the Bank of Canada and the Federal Reserve on policy divergence. Can we expect to see more of this in the new year?
Yes, there's always been periods of divergence. Another example would be in 2014-15, and that was when oil prices collapsed. We were cutting interest rates while U.S. interest rates were in a rising trend, and then it kind of reconverged afterwards. Usually it's when there's a commodity price movement that we get more of a divergence. But it can be because of aggregate demand shocks. You know, the U.S. economy may be in a different place. And of course, the equilibrator through all this has always been the exchange rate. So when things go a little bit divergent, the exchange rate does some of the adjusting. And there has been very little of that, as we mentioned earlier, this time around. And that's another reason why it's possible the Canadian dollar will find its feet in the next few months if the divergence becomes substantial. I don't really expect it to, because I think the fundamentals of the two economies are very similar. But if energy pricing remains really strong, then that would be one reason why we should see some ascendance in the Canadian dollar. And that divergence in the way policies are run in the two countries, it makes perfect sense for that to be the case.